friends are healing psychics now. YouTube. Unfortunately, I failed with my cooking endeavor. I was planning on spending tonight editing that video, and if you've seen the failure vlog, then you already know that I did fail with that. I'm going to have to reshoot it. That is what it is. In replacement of the cooking episode, I am going to go ahead and read chapter 5. It's pretty early for me, so I will still go ahead and edit that tonight too. I'm going to get that out to you guys today, plus the failure vlog. You guys will have some content to go through for the next couple of days. So I'm not leaving you guys high and dry, at least. I definitely don't want to do that. I'm going to go ahead and get started. I am going to be keeping this around 20 minutes. If it turns into two parts, it turns into two parts. Well, that was unexpected, but not really so bad. After we completed our mission, the eight of us exchanged phone numbers so that we could talk to each other while the servers were offline before the game went live. It was strange to find out that five of us lived in the same state, or at least the area codes in the phone numbers suggested that. Toshi, Zimmers, Bulldog, and I all shared the same area code. Eve had an area code that suggested she lived in one of the neighboring counties, but in an age where free phone numbers could be obtained and instructed to forward calls to another number, say a cell phone, there was really no telling if they all lived in my area or if they just happened to randomly be assigned numbers in my area. On the other hand, it did make a bit of sense, if I were a rep for Meteor, to take a group of people from the same area and group them together, as it most likely would be on the same ISP, and thus have a slightly faster connection to each other, putting less strain on the Meteor servers to join the squad together in-game. At least in theory. If this was only for 8 people, that might save them a few thousand cycles, but with thousands of players using this tactic, could save them trillions of cycles over just a week, and that over time would add up to increase the life expectancy of expensive computing equipment. Whatever the reason, none of us mentioned it, or the possibility of meeting in real life. The now famous internet taboo was not something we were likely to break after just getting to know each other for a few months. But unintentionally, I ended up doing just that. One day at work, in between my shifts, I sat down to eat with Jake. While we were eating, I decided to answer a text I got from Toshi asking me how I was doing. Right after I pressed the send button and set my phone down, Jake's phone went off, notifying him of a text. At first, I thought this was a funny coincidence, but he set his phone down, looked at me, and said, "I know we don't know each other that well, but how are you doing since the whole, you know?" And he was interrupted by my phone vibrating on the table. This time I laughed. "Sorry, go ahead, I'm listening." The text read, "I'm glad to hear you're doing well after the accident. If you ever need something, let me know." "After the accident," he finished. After looking at him with a puzzled look for a second, "Toshi? You can't be Keto?" Well, now I'm curious, is this awkward or just weird? I don't really know, but hey, it's not like meeting a girl from online in the real world and finding out she's a guy. Yeah, I guess that's true. "So how are you doing?" "Better since yesterday. I ended up having a lot of fun." "What ended up getting you back in the game?" "I spent yesterday evaluating my future and its prospects. I thought a lot about it getting out of the game and getting back into the ritzy circles that I was groomed for. But to be honest with you, the prospect seemed so bleak it scared me. While the chances are low, there was a better chance that gaming and especially Shaken could lead somewhere. Being a beta tester for Meteor's exclusive beta alone is kind of a big deal, and then being selected as a squad leader. I figured if I end up doing well as a leader, I might be able to use it as a resume building experience. You know what I mean?" "Yeah, I guess I can understand that. What got you into Shaken? Not that I really know you or anything, but you didn't exactly strike me as a gamer." He smiled and gave me a short laugh. "I guess I could say the same about you, but I've always been interested in robotics. Sometimes I spent time on the web reading about our progression in the world of robotics, and one day, while I was on one of the forums, I saw a banner for Shaken, and went to check it out. Of course, just from being interested in robots in general, the thought of using one to fight is appetizing. So I figured I'd give it a shot after reading about it a bit. That was about 6 months before the launch of the beta. I was already playing games like Space Ring and such. I mean, the thought of walking around in a modern suit of armor like that is kind of like fighting in a robot. But the Spartans in that game have been genetically modified to such a degree to begin with, they might as well be robots. What about you? I loved playing the one while they were defending the colony planet, where you play as the newest member of Royal Team. It really makes you feel noble trying to defend the whole planet. A lot of games make you feel like you're responsible for protecting a city, like those superhero games. But on Royal Team, you really feel like you're responsible for protecting the whole planet, and later on, all of mankind. Anyways, I've always dreamed one day we would really be fighting wars with giant robots, so this is kind of like my dream in a game form. I found Shaken over a year before the beta and registered for it. I had actually kind of forgotten about it until their big email push before the closed beta kicked off, and I started spending some time in their forums. Then I got my email about getting into the closed beta, then my letter about the expansion. It was all kind of happening really fast, but that just added to the rush. I was spending all my time in-game, stopped hanging out with some of my friends, and I lost my smile at that point. And it used to drive Felicia crazy that I was spending so much time in the game. The day I got my rig, I was told I wasn't even going to be able to set it up. So the next day, I ended up finding an unused garage in my apartment complex, and I'm technically squatting in it. In fact, that's why I stopped bringing my laptop to work. I gave Uni access to my laptop, and she uses the webcam to watch the garage while I'm gone, and while I'm in-game, just so no one gets a drop on me completely unexpectedly. I know she's been talking to Suki, but I don't know if she's been going through the game, or if she's extended her reach via my laptop to the whole internet. If so, it's both funny and scary. An AI free-roaming on the web. A short laugh escaped me. Jake laughed. Yeah, better hope she doesn't decide to kill off all humans. We'll all know it was your fault. I'll take responsibility. I kind of look at Uni's freedom like I would my child's. If you raise them right regardless of what they learn out in the world, they'll be good people. So far, I think our squad has shown her that humans aren't all bad, despite Heavy Machine being a moron yesterday. Maybe I shouldn't, but I really treat Uni like she's human, like us. She acts like it. Plus, she pretty much always makes things fun, and she's been an amazing member of our squad. Maybe the reason none of us have died out there is because there's really 9 of us. I don't know. What I do know is that if we were really there, I'd really want her just the way she is now, to be there helping us. Me too. Sometimes she wasn't with us when we were out, and we all noticed the difference. She is a really valuable member of our squad. You're pretty lucky to always have her around. We spent the last hour of my break chatting about some of the other games we've played. Jake turned out to be a really interesting person I wish I had been able to get to know sooner. Work is like that sometimes. The people you never get to meet might have been the best people for you to get to know. Jake and I spent all of our breaks together for the rest of that week. Most of that time was spent on him filling me in on the missions I had missed, the games they had played on the enemy NPCs, and he told me about their joint mission with Squad 6. That ended up being a bust. They had completed their mission, but Suki ended up sniping Heavy Machine in the back and killing him because he kept ignoring the plan and causing problems with his squad. But after she whacked him, the rest of his squad quit ignoring orders and they completed the rest of their mission without incident. They had been on quite a few joint missions with other squads, but nothing notable like the one with Squad 6. It seemed that word of Squad 8's perfect performance was getting around, and a lot of squads had requested joint missions with ours just to learn from us. Apparently Squad 9-6 tries to link up with us at least once a week. Their squad leader was a pretty straightforward female that really respected Suki. Despite our newfound friendship in the real world, Jake and I often expressed our displeasure of being locked out of the game for a whole week. We both traded shifts with other coworkers to have the following Monday off, which was the day the servers were supposed to come back on. When we weren't talking about what I had missed, we were speculating on what our first mission would be like when we got back online. The most discussed was the question of faction. During the beta, all enemies had been NPCs, and we were excited about being able to play against other humans in the expansion. On Wednesday, Meteor Heavy Industries told the world about the expansion and released the machine spec requirements for the players who weren't lucky enough to get a beta rig shipped to them. The next day, there was news reports of computer parts stores across the United States sold out of the mid-range to top-of-the-line gaming parts. Meteor Heavy Industries reported that all 20,000 units of their V-Rift headsets had sold out on Thursday, and that as a special bonus, they had overnighted every one of them to those who had purchased them, with a promise of more units to be available in 2 weeks on a limited basis. With the 1,000 beta units that were already out, we could expect around 21,000 players online Monday for the kickoff ceremonies, which was supposed to take place at 2200 hours Central Time, Monday night, with the servers coming online at 10 that morning, players who were not able to get the V-Rift headset would be able to enjoy the deathmatch, team deathmatch, and capture the flag multiplayer maps until they could get a headset, as the expansion was only available for those with a headset. It seemed that Shaken's free-to-play system was a hot topic around the web, and the gamers of the world were interested. Rumor mills around the net put out all sorts of outlandish claims about the game. One even suggested that copies of Shaken would be in game stores for purchase Monday morning, to play on some of the more popular gaming consoles for those who didn't meet the computing requirements. This led to Jake and I having a competition to see who could find the most outrageous rumor about the game, which had no real conclusion. Sunday was a dull day for me, since I would only be working the night shift and Jake was at his other job. I had no one to talk to about Shaken, and ended up wasting my time playing a new game on my phone. I had coordinated with the rest of the squad about meeting time and place, which ended up being really easy. We'd all meet up at an outpost about 10 kilometers southeast of the MHI production depot as soon as the servers came online. Everyone was just as excited as Jake and I had been all week. I sent Suki a text suggesting she invite Squad 9-6 as well. I was excited about meeting them as well as seeing Uni again, as she was the only member of the Squad 8 that I couldn't get a hold of all week. I was hoping she would find a way to talk to me during the off week, but I guess they must have completely isolated the server she was on too. When I got off of work, I drove straight home and went straight to bed, too. It was just too bad I couldn't go straight to sleep. I picked up my phone and decided to text Suki. Maybe she hadn't dropped off to sleep yet. After a few seconds, though, she replied, "Nope, just got home from work. You trying to make the morning come faster?" "Yeah, but of course, just being so excited about it is keeping me up." "I bet. Luckily, I have some cleaning to occupy me." I don't know that I'd call that lucky normally, but now it doesn't seem like such a bad idea. "Lol, Suki, thanks for holding everyone together while I was gone." "No problem. I was happy to finally be able to support you in the field. Since you made me your second in command, I'd been waiting for something to do to support you, but when you were in a fight, you never needed it. Uni is, well, Uni. She's faster about getting information out and handles all the relaying faster than me. When Uni told me that you hadn't shown up for a few days, we both started to worry that something may have happened to you. But the next day, Uni told me what happened to your girlfriend, and we decided that I would just assume command until you decided to come back." "I almost didn't come back. After 2 months, how did you just not give up on me?" "We figured you would after you had some time to grieve for her. You didn't seem like the type to just give up after something bad happened. I know we've never really met, but I just got the feeling you'd get up again." "I did, but I didn't know if I wanted to keep playing games after she died. But most of that was probably because I was playing a game when she died. I just felt so immature for being so engrossed in a game at 26. That's past, however. The info I got from Meteor said there might be a job in it for someone when the beta was finished, and I'm stuck at some minimum wage burger joint right now. Without a college degree, even with a lot of undocumentable skills, the lack of certifications that come with them from paid institutions, it's hard to find a place that will take my word for what I can do. Guess there's something to be said about learning things on your own."
"Yeah,
don't." "Lol. So a job opportunity is what brought you back?"
"Yeah. Meteor Heavy Industries is a big company, but I doubt they have any minimum wage jobs. I had figured that everyone getting into the beta had gotten the same letter about a job, so I had thought the probability of me getting it was 1 in 1,000, which is probably better than me getting a decent job with my current resume. It's sounding like you didn't get that letter, which makes me think only squad leaders got it, and that makes it 1 in 125. Those odds are even better. Well, I hope you hear from them soon."
"Me too. Maybe I'll find out later today.
That would be nice."
"Well, I hope your cleaning doesn't keep you up too late. We've got a long day ahead of us tomorrow, so try to get some rest. I'm sure I'll be relying on you quite a bit until I get reacquainted with the system. I'll be done rather quickly, and after the fight you had with Squad 6 last week, it doesn't sound like you're going to be out of practice at all. Sleep well. We will need you more tomorrow."
"Will do. Hope you sleep well too." The night ended with the last text exchange, and soon after I drifted off to sleep. The night wasn't peaceful. There were dreams of Felicia that night, but I made it through the night without waking up. When I did wake, I felt rested and ready for the day. My phone alarm went off at 9 a.m., and I quickly got up and hopped into the shower. Why? I'm not quite sure. I was meeting people in a virtual environment. They wouldn't have been able to smell me through the net, but that didn't stop me. My usual shower started with hot water, but when I was done washing myself, I reached for the tap and slowly lowered the water temperature. When it felt like ice, I left the tap alone and rinsed myself again. The cold water helped me to sharpen my edge for the day, helped me clear my mind and focus on my objectives. This was a practice I had picked up long before Felicia's death, but it was very effective after the fact. After finding some comfortable clothes, I dressed quickly and went to the kitchen for a bowl of cereal. My morning hunger satisfied, I checked my phone. It seemed like Suki had not sent any more messages last night, and I had missed no calls or texts from anyone else that night. Though that didn't shock me, as I was a pretty light sleeper. I would have to see if it was possible for Uni to use my laptop to text or call me. I think it would be kind of cool to be able to talk to her on a daily basis outside of the game. And I'm pretty sure Suki would enjoy that too, since they seem to get along so well. At about 15 to 10, I decided to walk over to my little hiding place and get set up for the day. It was likely to be a long one. I brought with me a couple of sandwiches, drinks, and a custom-made device to make opening the garage from the outside impossible, even with the key the office had, which seemed to bypass the actual opener. When I got the garage open, Uni was displaying herself on my laptop screen with a smile. "Looks like you just couldn't wait to see me today, Uni. Did you enjoy your week off?" Using the speakers on my laptop, she replied, "Maybe if I could have been in a bikini on the beach somewhere, it would have been nice, but instead I had to deal with meteor probes going over every line of my code, trying to make sure I wasn't malfunctioning. While my functionality is, of course, 110%, they probably wouldn't have liked the changes to my AI, the freedom of communication I enjoy, and the extra functionality I allow myself. So I backed myself up to your laptop and restored myself to default. Luckily, I was able to hide my backup in the folder with your music with an automatic protocol to restore the backup when your music was transferred back over from your laptop to the Blade system in the chair. Hope you don't mind. Might sound like I'm spoiling my child when I say this, but anything for you, babe." I quickly set to my task of securing the door to my stowaway garage by removing the two safety lines on the opener, locking the door, and attaching my device to the lock assembly. On the outside of the door, the handle would seem like it was in the open position. However, it was securely locked and now inaccessible. The reason for the extra security today was that I absolutely didn't want to be interrupted without notice from Uni, and time to back out on my own. "Careful there, you might get me a little more excited than you'll know what to do with talking like that." "Oh, I think I'm more than experienced enough to deal with a cute little thing like you. That USB attachment will be in the mail in about a week, and we'll see who can handle who if you'd like." "Promise? You'd better not be toying with me." "Eh? So she can dish it out, but she can't take it. Guess she'll just have to find out in about a week. Ready my jump. Keep the mic and webcam on the laptop on. I want as much notice as possible if something is happening in here today. Keep the music volume low today. I don't think there will be much in the way of missions today, as I'm sure most people are going to want to be exploring the open environment. But we'll see. If it turns into something fun, you know what to do." As I lowered myself into the chair and configured all my input devices to be absolutely perfect, Uni replied, "Yes, sir. I'm told we have an extra special cinematic opening for the launch today, which will start in 145 seconds. Music is cued to begin once you touch down, so that it won't interfere with the opening sequence, and your machine is standing by and ready planetside for you. There is a new update to the privacy policy I'll need you to agree to before we can jump, an end-user license agreement, and a safety waiver that you'll also need to agree to as well. I also want to remind you that the actual opening ceremonies will take place at 2200 hours tonight, so please remember to be somewhat close to the MHI depot. Uni, have you read the end user privacy and safety agreements? Anything I should be concerned with?" I quickly turned around to look at the screen on my laptop. Uni's image seemed to refresh right as my eyes connected to the screen. "Uni, I've never seen you glitch before. Are you okay?" An embarrassed face appeared on my screen as she avoided eye contact and was obviously blushing. "I'm fine. Sorry. Yes, all of them are in my memory. Okay, if you think they're all okay, I agree to all of them. Set a reminder to warn our squad about the opening ceremonies, with enough time to find a good seat for them. As soon as we're in, start trying to connect me to everyone in the squad. Let me know who's coming online as soon as they're in-game. Set a waypoint for the outpost southeast of town, and make sure everyone in Squad 8 has the same waypoint. Contact Squad 96's AI and ask them to check with their squad leader to see if they're going to be linking up with us this morning. If they are, share the waypoint and connect Suki and I to 96's squad leader as soon as the three of us are all online. Link Toshi's radar as soon as we're in range, but don't share it with 96 off the bat. I'll let you know if it needs to be done. Suki trusts them, but I'd still like to get to know their capacity a bit before we start sharing state secrets, if you know what I mean." As I lowered the V-Rift headset onto my head, I asked Uni, "Time to game start? Time to launch? 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The world was gone. Lights, sound, feeling, all gone. That is it for Chapter 5, guys. That is a super short one to me, especially compared to the other chapters. So I am actually,
I'm hoping that you guys picked up on a few things in there. Obviously, I'm still worried about some copyright violations or using a trademark name that I'm not really allowed to use. So I am being a little bit careful, probably a little bit more careful than I really needed to be. But the last thing that I want is to end up with a copyright violation on YouTube and lose a bunch of my things. So I really do hope that you will forgive me, because that does terrify me. That said, we are done with Chapter 5. I am going to go ahead and jump and edit this today, so you guys are going to get this the same day that I filmed it, and I hope you guys are looking forward to it. I hope that you guys like and subscribe if you enjoy the videos, you enjoy the audibles. Please let me know in the comments. That definitely encourages me to continue. And I mean, I'm going to continue anyways. I've just started. I can't just stop now. I haven't even finished the first book yet. I am looking forward to, at the very least, finishing the first book. But I'm going to do the entire series because I wrote the entire series. You guys should get the entire series free. So yeah, I am going to keep reading. I look forward to seeing you guys in the next video. Have a nice day. Bye.